This presentation will explore the relationship between population and urbanization. And we start the conversation by looking at ancient cities. Humans have been living in cities at least for 10,000 years. We don't have written records for the earliest cities, but we do have artifacts. And archaeology has been a very central discipline in studying this aspect of human urbanization. Go back to Çatalhöyük in Turkey or Jericho in the West Bank. Those range anywhere from 10,000 to 7,500 BCE. We have written records in Sumerian cities. The Epic of Gilgamesh comes from that. The city of Ur, which dates back to about 4,500 BC. And then in other parts of the world, we have other ancient cities like Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa in India, in the Indus Valley, going back about 4,000 BCE. And some of the remarkable cities of India continue to be populated, and perhaps the longest, like Damascus in Syria, the longest occupied city, continuously occupied city. In the United States, urbanization is a relatively recent phenomenon. When the country was founded in 1776, only about 1 in 20 people lived in an urban setting. At that time, Philadelphia was home to 42,000 people, what would be considered a rather small city by today's standards, perhaps even micropolitan. By the time of the Civil War in the 1860s, that had gone up to about 1 in 5 people living in a city. By 1950, the majority of the population, 2 out of 3 people, lived in a city. Now it's about 80%, and it's thought that it will continue to grow to be about 90% of the population by 2050. Much of the recent shift from a rural to an urban population in the United States, as well as other parts of the world, has a lot to do with the decline of agriculture as an occupation and the rise of industrial jobs, or now the service economy. If we turn our focus globally, we can see a similar pattern of declining rural populations and growing urban populations. The tipping point was somewhere between 2008-2010. It's not exactly known, but that's when the global urban population was thought to have surpassed the global rural population, and we're still in the early days of living in an urban planet. But if we look at some global trends, the wealthiest countries are the ones that are the most urbanized. There's certainly a close correlation between GDP and percent urban. Poor countries, still largely agricultural, many of them. About 33% of those live in a city, which is about where the United States was at the turn of the 20th century. So while as recently as 1950 the world was predominantly rural, with about 3/4 of the population living in a rural place, that trend is thought to reverse completely by 2050, with roughly three-quarters living in an urban setting. A quick look at a global map of urbanization reveals perhaps the most information. And we can see here that most of the remaining rural countries are heavily concentrated in the continents of Asia and Africa, particularly Southeast Asia and Central Africa. Northern Africa and South Africa are more urbanized, as are countries in Northern and Central Asia. And as you'll also note, nearly all of the Western Hemisphere is urbanized, with a few minor exceptions of Guyana and some Central American countries. An important theoretical question to ask is why people live in cities, or how are cities possible? And one of the key factors in thinking about that is the agricultural revolution, which unlocked the ability to feed populations beyond those that were gathering food for themselves, as defined most of human history as hunting and gathering organisms that we are. So farming essentially created the ability to live in sedentary settlements, and many of these, not all, eventually would go on to become cities. But an agricultural village is not the same as a city, and that's an important point. Of course, cities also play an important role in terms of politics and in terms of providing protection. Max Weber, for instance, pointed out that in order for cities to develop, There should be fortress-like walls, as has historically been the case in cities including the Ur and the Epic of Gilgamesh. Marketplace, separate political system. Other scholars have pointed out the need for occupations that are not in food or raw material production. We might call those occupations in urban production. And then political and occupational specializations that transcend kinship networks. In an attempt to explain where cities arise, Walter Kristaller developed central place theory, which essentially uses geometric principles and applies them to regions to identify which areas have central place functions, and it's those places that are likely to become cities. And that's where the population tends to flow, and out of that comes a kind of core-periphery dynamic that also underpins a form of regional inequality. And this is a graphical depiction of central place theory, where we have the center marketplace, the optimal location for access to peripheral areas, and access decreases with distance to the threshold, which is on the outer edges, and that's where we start getting into the rural area. Of course, not all cities are isolated. In fact, you can imagine cities growing into one another, creating overlapping areas, and is eventually becoming an agglomeration of one larger city. And a lot of cities that exist today have different areas, you know, that are recognizable because those areas were once separate entities. So as we wrap up our thinking of population and urbanization, it's a pretty safe conclusion to draw that we are becoming an increasingly urban species, human beings that is, as the planet continues to move towards being more urban. The consequences of that, however, remain largely open and perhaps not always good, even though the general assumption is that complete urbanization is a desirable outcome. There's certainly reasons to think about some of the problems that cities bring as well. Thanks for watching.